Good morning, welcome respected participants for the second session in which we have another distinguished speaker amongst us. In the chair is Brigadier Umar Farooq. Brigadier Umar Farooq is a alumnus of the Officers Training Academy in Chennai. He has commanded the Infantry Division Signal Regiment during Operation Parakram and is also been the Joint Director in the Financial Planning at Army Headquarters, Director Management Information System and Director, Army Commander Special Financial Bureau in Northern Sector. Brigadier Umar Farooq is an alumnus of the Defence Service Staff College Wellington and he did his post-graduation M.Tech from IIT Delhi. He is also an avid footballer and has represented Puducherry in the Santosh Trophy National Football Championship. Currently, Brigadier Umar Farooq is a General Manager, Defence and Control Systems Group, Electronic Corporation of India Limited. Can I kindly request you to chair this session, Brigadier Umar Farooq? Thank you.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I have the privilege of introducing one of the leading orthopedician who is going to talk to us, Dr. Kantilal Hastimal Sancheti. The doctor is an orthopedic physician who invented India's first indigenous knee implant, the Indus knee, and founder of Maharashtra's first orthopedic dedicated specialty hospital. He became an orthopedic surgeon by profession and started his practice in the year 1965. In the year 1972, he established a 10-bedded Sancheti Hospital, which has now grown to be a 200-bedded Sancheti Institute for Orthopedics and Rehabilitation in the heart of Pune city. Realizing the importance of education in delivering medical relief, Dr. Sancheti started medical educational institutes such as PG Orthopedic College for MS Ortho and D Ortho, recognized by Medical Council of India and affiliated to Maharashtra University of Health Sciences, Sancheti Institute College of Physiotherapy, affiliated to Maharashtra University of Health Science, and a postgraduate diploma in hospital management affiliated to Pune University. He has also established a research center recognized by the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Dr. Sancheti has also published many national and international articles and has patents to his credit. He lays maximum emphasis on research and indigenous implants and instruments, indigenous modification, and cost effectiveness. Currently, he is Professor Emeritus at Pune University of Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. He has also been foremost in guiding and teaching young orthopedic surgeons from various states to do knee replacement operations. The doctor has trained more than 300 surgeons and provided hospital consultancy to many hospitals. His social work efforts have been focused on handicapped polio children in rural India. He has organized free diagnostic and operative camps in various parts of India. As many as 437 such free camps have been held, during which 1 lakh disabled children were treated and 12,050 surgeries were carried out to correct deformities, and almost 20,000 calipers were provided to needy children free of cost. He has conducted numerous free surgical camps not only in India but also in neighboring countries. He has conducted camps for old people to fight against arthritis in many states, thus helping hundreds and thousands of old men and women to be active on their knees once again to lead normal and healthy life. There are many awards the doctor has been conferred with. The Government of India presented him with highest civilian awards, Padma Shri in 1991. Padma Bhushan in 2001, Padma Vibhushan in 2012. Numerous other awards includes Maharana Mewar Award by Maharana Mewar Foundation in 2003, Fellowship of the Royal College of Surgeons, Edinburgh, United Kingdom in 2004, Lifetime Achievement Award of the International Medical Integration Council from the Government of Maharashtra in 2004, International Award for Medical Excellence by Harvard Medical School in 2005, Jeevan Sadhana Gaurav Puraskar by Pune University in 2010. Without taking much time, I hand over to Dr. Sancheti to proceed further with today's program. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Baldev Raj, the director, Brigadier Umar, chairman, and dear friends. I can't tell you how happy I am today here to stand in front of you, a doctor, but in front of scientists and trying to say something. Thank God there is a podium because my legs are shivering, you can't see them. Delivering a lecture is an art and we somehow are lag behind, but I'll try to make it best. I'm happy to share with you that I'm completing this year, I completed 50 years of my practice. Change is inevitable. Look at my photograph when I was 30 and look at my photograph when I'm 80. Well, I accept the change. And with this, look at the life. The life is fascinating journey, full of opportunities, experiences, and therefore achievements. Leading a change is very important. Those who fail to change will fail eventually. Changing is inevitable, therefore embrace it. As you see, in nature, every season there is a change. And what best we can learn from the nature, not only to change, but to grow. For a change to occur, we have to use head, heart, and the hand. Thinking and understanding is the first step. Then, without emotional involvement, as Chidambaram said, passion, you can't take it ahead. And with the hands and behavior, you can take it to the highest level where you want to get it done. How to do that? First, I identify the problem, then bring a change and sustain it all the time till you achieve it and deliver it. With this humble introduction, I very humbly like to present my life journey. I'm born in a middle class family. I was staying in a chawl where there were 20 people staying, 20 families and common Latin, etc., etc. This was the beginning of my life. My father had a small food grain shop in 10 by 10 size of the shop, and also a small tea stall in front of in Pune where there is a Vijay Talkies. While working with my father, I learned hard work, dignity of labor, and dealing with the people. It just reminds me of one incident when I was weighing the rice and giving it to the customer. By gravity, the balance became this way and I was trying to give that. My father was standing next to me. He saw it. He slapped my hand. Wait, put some more rice. Let the balance come in the center and then give it. And then in the evening, explained me, he is a person because of which I am able to give you food. I'm able to give you education, so don't betray anybody. Believe me, since that time till today, I have not done, and I remember my father every time whenever there is such situation. Before I go there, let me tell you another story, provided you don't tell anyone. I secured 46% marks in SSC. And then that time, now it is 11th, that time it was first year science. When I went to college from school, it was a different atmosphere. And then I started taking part in general activities and very little time I used to give for study. As such, even school also I didn't study. The result was my percentage dropped down from 46% to 35%. Now here I can tell you the importance of a friend. I was staying in the Narayanpet in the same area. There were two other friends of mine, Dr. Karanik and Dr. Kukde. They were children of doctors. So three of us used to go together in Ferguson College on a cycle and come back. Then we decided, why not to study together? It was a golden opportunity for me. So when we studied together, I found my friends could read 30, 40 pages in 1 hour, and I could read only 15. Then I remembered, my father told me, God doesn't send anybody empty-handed. Maybe I was poor in reading and academic, but I was very robust in the hard work. They were studying for 5 hours a day. I studied 11 hours a day, and result was that all three of us got admission in the BG Medical College in 1956. I completed a course in due time. I didn't take any extra time. I completed the course in 65. Then I did general practice for 1 year because I couldn't afford further education immediately. Earned some money. There I came in contact with Dr. Koyaji. Koyaji was a very philanthropic doctor. He used to see 2,000 patients a day, old man of 70. And just I learned one more thing there. When I went to see him first, he was sitting in office. And at the age of 70, he was reading a book, Gray's Anatomy. My goodness. Practicing for so many years and then reading a basic book of anatomy was something which I learned. And then I learned everything in life. Every time you have to learn, learn and learn, and learn is never an ending process. Then I got admission in KM Hospital, Bombay, but completed my MS Orthopedics in November 65. Now, why I'm telling these dates, there is another interesting story I want to tell you. November 65, I passed MBBS, and on 12th December 65, I started the practice. How? I had hardly any money in my pocket, but in the month of August, 3 to 4 months before my examination, there was one doctor, Dr. Motwani in Pune. He unfortunately expired, and his wife wanted this nursing home to be run by someone. I went and approached her. You know, what is important in life type? The courage. We were discussing about the courage and entrepreneurship. So before I passed MS Orthopedics, in the month of September, I made a contract with her and started paying the rent. I passed the examination in November, and on 12 December, I started the practice. Here is a photograph that my teacher, late Dr. A.K. Telwakar, came from the Bombay and inaugurated my hospital. At that time, orthopedics was not a known specialty. This work was done by general practitioners, and except Bombay, all over Maharashtra, there was not a single orthopedic surgeon. I was the only one outside the Bombay practicing in Pune. Then I thought I must popularize the orthopedics all over Maharashtra. So I, knowing this demand, I brought a change by doing visiting various places where I can deliver lectures. My capital during that time was values from my parent. Really, I value much even today. That is the best capital which I have. Then blessings from my teacher. Teachers are important people who have changed my life and made me to this position. Hard work, which was perhaps genetic, and I learned from my mother, and entrepreneurship. I'm always there to take risk and proceed further. To spread awareness in orthopedic branches, I conducted lectures, seminars all over Maharashtra and neighboring countries. This was for the general population and also for the doctor. Going to their place, talking to them, was the best opportunity, I thought, to increase the subject. So in 1965, I started my practice in a rented place. In 1969, in a period of about 4 years, I could purchase a place and set up a hospital where at present there is a joint replacement center in one of the two buildings of the hospital. That time, I had no staff. My wife was working as a nurse, my younger brother was working as a receptionist, and I had to do a multitasking business. I learned there all vocations. I was the surgeon in chief, we can call. I was the administrator. I was the personal department in charge, management, finance, architecture, law, and marketing, and whatnot, and whatnot. Architecture was one of the line where if I would not have got admissions for medical, I would have gone to architecture. So I had a special interest, so much so, later on, I studied a passive solar architecture such a way that even Government of India called me once to give lecture in the various parts to propagate the passive solar architecture. Union was a great problem that time when I started the practice, and therefore I had to study all the labor laws and etc. And then I was in a good position to deal with them and solve the problems of the union. I was pioneer in various aspects because there was no other person before me. I was the first in Pune, the first dude, the partial hip replacement operation, the total hip replacement operation, the total knee replacement operation, and then there was also an operation to correct the spinal deformity we call correction of scoliosis. In the initial days, when I started practice, all surgeries were done by myself. I had done the surgery on polio, from pediatrics to geriatrics, from trauma to elective cold surgery, for amputations to joint replacement surgery. Name operation, today various specialists are doing, which I had done that time. And this was, again, giving you the grip of the total subject better. Before I started the practice, the general practitioner, general surgeons, were doing orthopedic surgery. But after we started the practice, there were more surgical operations required, and there was more percentage of infection. To reduce the infections, I studied the bacteriology in detail, then the subparticles, the dust particles, etc. And I'm very happy to tell you, in 1979, I developed the first laminar flow, indigenously manufactured and fixed-fitted in my operation theater. Thanks to Kirloskars, they helped me, and then I got the immense knowledge about the air circulation. The dust particle, smaller than 0.3 micron, is a carrier of the bacteria. And all the post-operative infections are seeded during the surgery. So a laminar flow I created with 0.3 micron HIPAA filters with the laminarity speed of 100 feet plus or minus 10 per minute, which gave me a bacteria-free environment in the surgery. And since then, all over India, the laminar flow concept is become popular. Today, you go and see any theater, any advanced hospital, all the theaters are fitted with laminar flow, which I am the pioneer in that. At that time, the most of the treatment of fractures and other illnesses were to give plaster. I remember giving a plaster to a TB spine patient right from head till up to the toes and ankle, and we used to keep them in that plaster for 3 months or 6 months. Certain people where the fracture of the thigh bone is broken, from the umbilicus down below, we used to keep them in one plaster, and that was the treatment. I made a change by inventing the implants at lower cost and premium quality. Just now, Dr. Chidambaram was talking that initial what we want to do for us, I agree with him 100%. If you go for too much precision or aesthetics, the cost increases. And our basic requirement has to be a cost-effective implant. So that time, without compromising the function, I accepted little tolerances and little aesthetic look and developed a lot of implants to fix the fractures indigenously available during that time at 1/3 cost of the imported one. This was my beginning, because this I learned from Dr. Talwalkar, who was my teacher and who was also of the opinion that we must develop indigenous implant to look after our patient at very, very minimum cost. This particular thing I went on. Then while conducting lectures to popularize the orthopedics to general practitioners, I found in the villages there were a lot of children were walking with deformities, and they were all polio affected children, and that gave me insight to do some work for the polio children in early 70 with a huge percentage of polio in the rural area. What I did that time, it was essential for us to go to the doorstep of the villages, and you can find, look at the photographs, the places where we went. Even the postman didn't go to deliver their lecture, such was the place, and started conducting camps. What I used to do, Friday night at 9 o'clock after completing the OPD, I will sit in my ambassador card and shake my driver. We'll take every day night, we'll travel all night, Saturday morning reach to some place and conduct camp, do some surgery Saturday, Sunday. Sunday night travel back to come back to the hospital Monday. And believe me, this I used to do for days together, every Saturday, Sunday. Whenever there were five Sundays in a month, my wife used to get one Saturday, Sunday for herself, for which she never objected and supported me. I thank her very much for my proposed growth. Spreading awareness, as I mentioned, you traveled all the places in Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh. You name a place in Madhya Pradesh or Karnataka here, and you will find I have traveled there. My another strength was 24/7. Incidentally, I am born on 24th July. That is 24/7. And therefore, I can work day and night. And I am born in 36. In Marathi, we say, Chhattis Takda, means rest, no. 36 means no rest, 24/7 we work all the time, and therefore I used to work all weekends, even during festival and even during holidays. There was, I will talk to you later on, it became my passion, and that gave me strength. So Colonel Brigadier Saab, you mentioned the statistics. During that time, I conducted 437 camps, which was a huge, huge, big number. Nobody has done work that much to that extent. I saw more than 100,000 children. More than 10,000 were operations done either in their place or in my hospital free of charge, because these children could never have afforded any. And then I gave caliper to, again, more than 20 patients. How I used to do? I used to approach some local philanthropic samstha. You know, every place there is one group. They do some work for the children neighborhood. I will go and approach them, talk to them, and tell them I can look after your children. And I used to put their name on forefront. If any children were to be brought from the rural areas to my hospital, I will write to that man. And then that man, the in charge of that local samstha, will approach the boy and see that he comes to the hospital taken back. And that's how involving more people was another important aspect of this work, to get this work done at the doorstep. What change I have brought? The change because of this wide experience, I developed new certain operations to treat the deformities, reduce the disability to a great extent, and now you can see, with the help of the Lions Club, Rotary and other, the polio is totally eradicated, and today we do not see any polio child, which we used to see in abundance in my early practice, days of the early practice. Well, I believe one thing, when you want to become useful to someone, God gives you double benefit. And believe me, these are the things which I want to share with you. Because of that surgery, it improved my surgical skill, because I did a lot of operations. lot of operations. Again, you, within short time, with less expenditure, etc., while doing the operations in camp, I improved my surgical skin. I innovated so many new operations which are printed in the books and published. Nowadays, polio is not there, therefore that doesn't come now, but that time it was being published to many books. Whatever observations I did, I collected the data, and on that data, I got a PhD of Pune University, and there again, in the Pune University, rehabilitation, a PhD on rehabilitation, I became the first research fellow. Research publications I did, and government recognized this work, and offered, gave me Padma Shri in 1991. Increasing population is the first, nowadays we feel a big problem. When I started the practice during that time, the average expectancy was about 47 to 48 years. Now it has gone to more than 65. What does it mean? It means more old people and more geriatric operations to treat. This was one change. Another change, high velocity trauma on accidents because of the so many vehicles, better roads, etc., was another change was there in front of us. An increasing demand of orthopedic treatment. This change was required to convert the nursing home into a dedicated operation institute. So my 15-20 bedded nursing home, I converted into a big institute. That time I started with 50 bedded institute, and now it has become 200 beds. This particular institute creation, these were the few points on which I started up with creating institute. In 2008, I started one more unit of joint replacement center where Pratibhatai, former president of India, came and inaugurated that particular hospital. So on one side, I was delivering medical aid to the doorstep. On another side, also developing an institute for the tertiary care center, and so much so, today it is 200 bedded hospital with two buildings and more than 700 people working for the patients. And this is one photograph we took. We collected all them on the outside the hospital, and you find how many people are working for me. Even though I was doing all the surgeries myself, today we have kept the space with the modern requirement. So we have got a separate joint replacement department, arthroscopic department, spine surgery, there are three units, the shoulder department, or oncology department, trauma, emergency, etc., medical, rheumatology, all the subspecialty of orthopedic, and that department is with us. So that much of the growth we have done nowadays for giving the medical help. Along with that, I also found that if I convert my institute into an educational center, I can get resident doctors to work for my patient, and that will reduce the cost again. That time, all the time I was thinking about it. So in 1974, Pune University recognized my hospital as a teaching complex of the BJ Medical College, and it was the first non-governmental hospital to be recognized not only by Pune University, but Medical Council of India, for which I am very, very proud. Today, we have got 8 MS orthopedics admissions per year, 5 diploma in orthopedic admissions per year, and even you go to any medical college, their admissions in orthopedics are not more than 3 to 4. But because of my all colleagues working for so many years, they got recognized by university, and therefore there so many seats are there. Along with that, I realize my patient must have good physiotherapy. So how to get a physiotherapist? So I started graduate and postgraduate physiotherapy college. Along with that, I was fond of management. So I started a diploma in hospital management. All these things created additional support for my hospital to do at a minimum cost. This was all the time in front of me. How can I deliver medical healthcare at a lesser cost? Now, along with your hard work, you need some philosophical approach. I recognized the importance of meditation, pranayama, and believe in me, at 6:30 sharp, I go to the hospital, 6:30 sharp, 1 second, the door is closed. We start the day with meditation. If I ask him to do, say, meditation for 15 minutes, it increases the ability to concentrate. Any work you do which requires concentration, so also the surgical work. And if you do anything in concentration, that itself becomes meditation over a period of time. Based on this principle, I make them meditate for 15 minutes. After that, I share my experiences, how I came up, what entrepreneurship I had, how I jumped upon the opportunities, and that I talk to them for 5-10 minutes. And at 7 o'clock, we sharp start a class. At 7:30 to 8:30, all my orthopedic surgeons gather together. They are now 18 number, and we take clinical meeting every day. The meeting, agenda of the meeting is whatever operation, discussion about admissions, whatever operations we are going to do, they are discussed by each and everyone. So no unindicated operations be done in my institute. And post-operative, next day, third agenda is whatever operations are done yesterday are presented there. This is the clinical meeting. Then after 8:30, full whole day, everybody goes to their different department and works. And that's how, in a way, it has helped me to keep a control on the whatever happening in the institute. And another way, it is also useful to everyone. My residents know what that particular surgeon is doing, what other people are doing, and that gives me a good sort of control and view of the things happening. That's what we do every day. And the day is passed, my resident work whole day, and in the night, once in a month, once in 3 months, we have a party together. Everybody mixes, talks, have drink, and enjoy. So that is our work culture. We have kept it there. So there is alumni, and more than 300 orthopedic surgeons have been trained. We, once in a year, we have an alumni meeting where whatever work they do, because they do a small work, they don't get platform in the big conferences. Here we provide the platform. Even the smallest innovation, they can present, and we come together, have a good evening, and this. Now, the pediatric problems are over, and now geriatric problems have started. So I change focus of my change or innovation from pediatric to geriatric. As I advised just on talk, the life expectancy is increasing, and there are more and more old people are seen nowadays. So I continue conducting camps, but instead of children, I now do camps for the old people. Then all this, you can see in the camp, they come, I treat them. And what are the observations? The observations are osteoarthritis of the knee is common in every second patient, because of the bow legs. Most of them are in advanced stage, because they can't reach the doctor, or sometimes they feel it's a curse of God, it is going to remain like that, and they don't worry about it. And I found very many of them are suitable for joint replacement operation. But the joints available were imported and expensive. That was the big hurdle. So there was a need to change a joint. Cost was one aspect, and social habits of sitting cross-legged was another hurdle. All the imported knee replacement surgeries today do not allow you to sit cross-legged. But this is my design, which allows you to sit cross-legged, have a complete movement, and more than 100 degrees, and most important is affordable. Again, I repeat Dr. R. Chidambaran's sentence. Initial period, it was not looking very aesthetically well, but I did not compromise on the basic requirement. Maybe little tolerances compensated, tolerate accepted to reduce the cost. Because reduction of the cost was very important. The imported joints were causing 90,000 rupees, and this joint I am able to give you in 20,000 rupees or so. So that it became affordable, more and more people started coming. And what I did, how I did invention, I analyzed all the drawbacks of the current implants available. Their major drawback was limitation of movement and inability to sit cross-legged. Then I studied the normal kinematics and also the kinematics of the artificial knee, established a design philosophy. Then I want a big complete range of movement. What I want, rotation in the joint to sit cross-legged. So this I follow philosophy. First I finalize, then actual drawings will be made with the aid of engineers. Believe me, I now am able to work on AutoCAD. I can make all the drawings. I can read all the drawings. I know PROE, CATIA, and other modeling softwares. All I learned myself. And then other problem was there. No research facilities, no labs testing. Scientists or engineers who have designed the joint and they are expert in abroad, they were not available. And Indian demography and anthropopathy was not available. So I took 50 patients, did their scanning, found out the ratio of the bone by mediolateral dimensions, anteroposterior dimensions, and then established a particular design. There were no manufacturing facilities. They were all big industries in Pune, all automobile industries. But to whom I used to go, even a small vendor, they will say, what is the quantity? When I said my quantity is 100, 150, they never used to entertain me. And then my ability was desire, attitude, and willingness to prepare. What I did, I saw all the manufacturing units all over the world, purchased the raw material, and started a manufacturing unit in the basement. In the basement there was a store. I vacated the store, brought this equipment. I'm the first 5-axis VMC with 17,500 spindle speed to bring in orthopedic industry. Started in that VMC, then vacuum packing, polishing, and again in orthopedic industry, I went to a small food processing unit, and they pack with vacuum. Small equipment, I purchased them, and I was able to do vacuum packing because oxygen, when we give radiation, may oxidize the polyethylene tissue, therefore vacuum packing was necessary. We had strict quality control on raw material, quality of finishing product, and my steps were to go towards FDA and E-mark. This is the implant, how I look. I gave the name Indus. The Indus is where the first civilization started, and therefore I thought this is the right name. So I developed, this is an Indus knee, developed by Indian for the India and made in India. Now make in India is another issue nowadays. So first orthopedic surgeon among 37,000 to develop the Indus. The first surgery was done in 2005, and subsequently more than 5,000 surgeries have been. It is not only economical, but has the best design specificity for the Indian population. Flexion is more than 35 degrees. Look at the photograph. How much knee is bent, and yet there is no impingement. Then I got the patent then, and later on the patent I gave to one company because to manufacture it on commercial basis was not my baby. My baby was to develop a research facility. So I gave it to the Bio-Rad company, and they popularized it all. Nowadays, even in neighboring countries, these implants are given. I go there, I demonstrate the surgery. Even last week, I was in Myanmar, in Rangoon. There I did 8 surgeries, 8 days I stayed there, demonstrated how I do, gave a couple lectures, and popularizing this in other countries. Now, the video would have been really good, how this lady was walking on the left side, and how the lady is straight on another side. See another bowed legs lady, the legs have become straight. The videos are really worth seeing, but somehow. Then bone and knock knees operated. One knee bend, another knee bend on opposite side, operated. This is again. See, so severe deformities. They were not able to walk. They have been operated, make the loin straight. And here is one photograph which can show the implant in the knee joints. These are various cases. Even deflection. See how much knee can bend. That is all. These are the... Then this is one video where I called everybody for follow-up, and this was Ganesh Chaturthi days. So I made them sit on the ground and gave them modak and etc. to eat. So this video shows everybody sitting on the ground. There are 50 patients sitting on the ground and eating food all together, is sitting in a cross-legged position. It was a great pleasure for me to observe that particular thing. So innovation in other joint, then I started doing. Then shoulder joint I developed, elbow joint I developed, the hip joint I developed, and the hip coating is being developed nowadays with hydroxyapatite coating. This is the for the fractured neck of the femur. Then there are other joints, and these are the joints I'm developing with the help of CGCRI for ceramic material. Because nowadays, ceramic is, delta ceramic, you can say, is in vogue. And in olden days, the metallic head and polyethylene used to wear out in 15 years, 12 to 15 years, and that was a major point from longevity. So material nowadays used is ceramic, on which we are working. Immense, what is the fruit? Fruit is the immense satisfaction from achieving the goal, and it helps lots of patients, that is the real interest. All this work, Government of India recognized me in 91 for Padma Shri, 2003 Padma Bhushan, 2010 Padma Vibhushan, but best recognition for me are two. One of them is my peer, my colleague, Dr. Ranawat, who comes from America, conducts seminars and conferences, and he gave me Lifetime Achievement Award and decorated me. He, along with Dr. Lad, my another friend, helped me a lot to do this innovation and make it to the public. But another big satisfaction is the National Institute of Advanced Studies is calling me to give my lecture on change. What more you expect? A big scientist sitting here and listening to me, where in front of you I am nothing. And still all of you are enjoying my lecture and are listening to you. What more pleasure you want in the life? And this is the best pleasure I had. The journey should continue, and generations to come. It should not end there. Now I handed over the reins to my colleague. My son is also an orthopedic surgeon, and these are my other colleagues who are specialized in this branch. I have handed over hospital management to them. I go to hospital, do my some hip replacement operation, see the patient, but now the hospital is being run by the newer generation. However, being old man, I must give some advice. Advice is reduce the resistance to change. You know, there are a lot of people. You must understand the change is required and find out, adopt it. Always grow. Another nature, a seed can become into a tree. What is it? It is nothing else but to grow. Humbleness. Humbleness and humility is one which will allow you to raise the steps faster and achieve your goal earlier. Be good in public relations. Never say that you are a big that. Go and meet with anybody, maybe a ward boy, maybe anybody. Talk to them. Don't show your position. Let them feel that you are one of them. Entrepreneurship. Everyone must have the nature of ability to take risk. So many times we feel, no, how can I do that? How can I do that? No. Go and take risk, calculated risk, and you will grow. Punctuality. If you want to have more time out of 24 hours, be punctual. Everywhere, don't take it casually. And don't give silly answers. Oh, traffic jam was there, this was there. We know there is a traffic jam. So why don't we not start early? Maybe you may reach 10 minutes earlier, but that will give you punctuality. The whole day you will go with fulfillment of your duties, enhance what you had. I had the ability to do hard work, and hard work has given me what I have seen. Positive competition. Dr. Dholakia taught me, never criticize anybody in the life. Never, never, never. And that has helped me. Avoid negative competition. Don't, even though you win the race by negative competition in a rat race, you are still a rat. Don't do that. Be vigilant. Yes, one more point my father taught me. Be humble and useful to others. But, be useful to others. But, during that process, if anybody is taking you granted, are taking advantage of you, be vigilant, not allow anyone to take your advantage. That is also equally important. Being humble, humility is one part, but not to allow others to take advantage of you also is another part. Passion. Everybody talked about passion. Nothing can be done without passion. Nothing. You people need much more than what I need. It reduces the stress and fatigue. And in the evening, you'll find you are more energetic than in the morning. That's what the passion does. Improve knowledge and skill. Personal discipline. Even at the age of 80, I'm able to go here and there because I get up at 4 o'clock. 4:30 to 6:30, I do exercises, pranayama, meditation. Come to the hospital, and my advice to everyone, after the age of 60, you can tax your body up to 55. After that, you must do some exercise every day to maintain your body, free gift given by God, nurture it well. To summarize, remember, if you want to achieve success, then don't doubt the dreams. Don't doubt the dreams. Okay, do any dream. Don't doubt them. And last, there is no shortcut to achieve goal. Hard work and smart and balance is the only way to succeed. I thank you very much for your kind attention and thankful to Dr. Balraj and giving me this opportunity to be with them. Namaskar.
Thank you. Of crossing your hospital a number of times, but I was unaware of the yeoman service and the kind of work that you have done and given as a gift to the people of this state, sir. And the country. My question, sir, is that all of us always wish to be in the best of health and avoid hospitals and courts of law as much as possible. But the while law one may be able to avoid, there are very few of us lucky enough to be able to avoid going to hospitals. And when you have to get admitted for some major surgeries or things like that, the hospitals come out as a pretty depressing place. I don't know if you've seen a movie by the name of Patch Adams of Robin Williams. The kind of work they're doing, I'm sure, sir, you will enjoy that movie. I'm sure there are a lot of lessons to be learned from that particular movie, that how a doctor can make even a place like a hospital such a happy place where people do not mind going to. So it's just a suggestion, since you have been doing such wonderful work, and I would only recommend that, you know, something that can be fine, particularly because the number of people who looking for cheaper hospital expenses, and you find even in places like the AIMS and so on, you find people on the roadside, ladies giving birth on the roadside because they're not able to get the admission into the hospitals. Your advice or your suggestion to the government, I would say at the highest apex body, as to how these things can be made more, for the people.
Correct.
So that, sir.
You raised 2 points. First was the atmosphere in the hospital, and second, the type of hospital. The best way to create a good atmosphere in the hospital is to become very friendly with the relatives, etc. In the initial period, I can share with you, when I lay staff, when I will go to the room, and there is an old lady and a young lady helping that old lady, which is undergone some operation, I knew that she is a daughter-in-law. But I will ask that lady, is she your daughter? She will say, no, my daughter-in-law. Then I will say, dekho, aapke bachche jaisi ho, aapko service de rahi hai. So I used to motivate the relatives to get help and reduce hierarchy. Talk, let everyone, you first, everything starts from the top, then it percolates down. The moment you are free, easily accessible, talking, smiling face, the atmosphere in the house, in the hospital will change. This is very strictly followed in our hospital. My daughter, she also keeps smiling face all the time. She smiles even without a cause, but atmosphere created is one. So in Western countries nowadays, the science is taken over by law. and Consumer Protection Act and other things are making to fill up 100 forms, and the personal touch is totally going, plus advancement in technology. We must strike a balance and do not compromise the human need of care. So please, I recommend everyone to maintain the human need of care by giving a smile, showing concernness. This is one which can reduce the gloomy atmosphere. And even though you make 7-star hospitals, and if everybody is standing with a grave face, you will never be comfortable. But a small hospital, not with big pardas and big environment, and giving smile, bowing bit, receiving them, talking to them, will give them immense satisfaction. So this is one needed. Modern technology and Consumer Protection Act are getting us away from the human touch and the human concern, which is a very strong point of our Indian culture. Second, there are two kinds of hospital required. One for affluent caste, where all modern facilities, investigations are required, and they will be expensive. And another class of hospital, where is a low-cost one, where government should call some private agencies and let them invest in the equipment and let them maintain in the equipment. I know in my hospital, Sassoon Hospital, Government Hospital in Pune, that they purchased MRI. After 3 months, something went out of order. And believe me, for 1 year, now that machine, in spite of big investment, that machine is not working. So government are unable to buy expensive equipment and more unable to maintain them. So let them have a private partnership in terms of modern equipment, join them together, charge a bit, and give better service than today for the middle class. Even lowest class patient can afford some price which can be charged by giving this investment. This is, according to me, this would be the answer to solve both kind of requirements.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
The path to realizing many of our dreams,
yes,
are told to be based on two or three major things. One is personal sacrifices, availability of capital,
yes,
and invisible roadblocks from either society, environment, or any of these. In the length of your career and your,
yes,
fulfillment of your dreams, I would just like to know how you tackle this.
Right. Personal point of entrepreneurship, I was very much always thinking of highest level, which is unreachable. Then another thing, which is very important, in 1986, government came with the idea of research R&D income tax rebate. Those who can give 100 rupees donation to any charitable institution, the donor will get rebate on 133 rupees, and income tax slab was 77%. 70% income tax, 10% surcharge. And what I did, then I found this particular thing. I went to Revenue Department, Government of India, ICMR, and again I was there to get that certificate, so much so that Bharatiya Cutler Hamel Company from Delhi, Tata, so many other industrialists from Bombay donated me money, 50 lakhs, 75 lakhs, because by donating me, they were benefited. So that's how I collected we must keep our eyes vigilant. Whatever, from where I get money, I went to Department of Science and Technology to get some help for my R&D project. So not keeping there also, the entrepreneurship is required. To get a finance, find out which are the various sources, from where you can get, approach them, talk to them. And I realized, and I got this R&D certificate. Today I got a certificate where 170% the income tax deduction is given for anybody who donates 100 rupees to my hospital. That's how I generated funds. And last question was?
I asked about personal sacrifices, if any, and any other hurdles in terms of other people trying to stop you.
Yes. There were a lot of hurdles. In Pune, I am not Brahmin. Sorry for that. So there were a lot of hurdles. But my guru, very important message I want to tell you. J.P. Vaswani taught me two things, very important. Everyone, please listen carefully. Give and forgive. Give and forgive. Anybody who's criticizing you, forgive them. If you try to justify yourself in front about that, it causes more discussion, more hurdle. So to satisfy you, to have less stress on mind, why did he say like that? Why did he is putting a struggle in my project, this. Forgive him. God forgive him. So don't take it to your heart. On the contrary, tell God to forgive him. This is one hurdle which I overcome. What another point, last hurdle?
I spoke of personal satisfaction.
May I tell you, again, pardon me if I'm philosophical, the personal satisfaction is so immense that I'm ready to die this moment. What more you want? Personal satisfaction, immense personal satisfaction. My children has gone well. I was a son of a poor father. So I was humble. So I had no other choice. But my children, they are not children of a poor father, but they are equally humble. Because my atmosphere in the house, I kept simple atmosphere. My children used to go to school, etc., by public transportation. And that kind of atmosphere I provided in the house never was carried away my richness or something like that. Of course, I'm not very rich, but sufficiently rich to take care of myself, my old age, my children, my wife, etc., etc. So, whatever you, in childhood, I thought if I buy a Lambretta scooter, that time Lambretta scooter was very much good in automobile. So, that time I used to feel, if I buy a Lambretta scooter, I touch the heaven. Today I got a Mercedes car. Everyone respects me well. You have called me for giving a lecture. What more I want in life? That gives me immense, immense satisfaction. Thank you.
One question.
Yes.
You told in your talk that you used to go to different places.
Yes.
For doing operations for polio patients and all that.
Yes.
What kind of equipment for and sophistication you used to carry for those operations?
Correct. To do an operation, you need a place with four walls and a clean place. And to do a polio surgery, you need equipment in terms of scalpel, scissor, needle, bleeding, some forceps to catch the bleeder, tourniquet, rubber tourniquet to tie to the leg to stop the bleeding. So tourniquet. Then certain anesthesia material, certain antibiotics, certain drugs required in operation theater, and instruments. I made a one big bag, which was kept aside. Every time when I'll go, I'll carry that bag with me, which contained all the requirement, all this equipment and other things required, and fumigation 24 hours. I will tell the nurse, train the local nurse, tell her to take away all the unnecessary material from the room, close the doors, put the tape, close the window, and put the fumigating potassium permanganate and other things material to fumigate it, make it sterile, and then I will operate next day in the theater. Polio surgery, being surgery in children and superficial, were not that difficult and not that requiring stringent requirement of operation theater. That was the situation. Yes.
Hello. Dr. Sancheti.
Yes.
Your life story is really very touching.
Thank you, sir.
I really felt great to hear it because your story somehow has changed life of so many thousands and lakhs of people. That is where probably it is more touching.
Thank you, sir.
I'm really tempted to ask you one question.
Please. Any question?
You must have faced a lot of hurdles to reach here. Can you tell us what were the biggest hurdle you faced so far and how did you overcome that?
Right. The biggest hurdle was a place. To start, one physical hurdle was I wanted a place to build up this big hospital. I will tell you a small story that how God has been great. One IAS officer came to my OPD. This is before, when there was a small hospital. And when I saw his card, that so-and-so, IAS, title, I went and took him inside immediately, treated his sister, is free. And then I learned he was a revenue secretary in government of Maharashtra. Then I was struggling to get that place, meet the collector, other people, etc., etc. But I got that source, and I met him, and I got the place. There was a jhopadpatti, 1,000 jhopadpatti in that place. Collector then collaborated and cooperated, and he evicted the jhopadpatti, gave some alternative place in the Yerawada area, and I got that place. Then another hurdles which used to get was a little negative publicity. Dr. Sancheti operates in any kind of atmosphere. He doesn't take care, and he is a butcher, etc., etc. That kind of publicity was done by other people who scared to come to me sometime. What I did, I called the Indian Medical Association branch of Pune. I called them inside. I made them to see all my theater and facilities. Then I arranged a press conference, and I made them to talk to the press what they have seen in the hospital. And that's how, and then later on, my personal contacts, my patients feeling, you know, one important thing in medical profession is the biggest title what one should earn is my doctor. You know, if you are got some trouble and you are satisfied with my treatment, and when you go to your place or village and somebody has got similar problem, what you say? Don't worry, I will take you to my doctor. And then that title I earned very fast. I became so friendly with all of people, they used to call me my doctor. That one-to-one publicity overcome that negative propaganda, and my practice went on increasing. Barring that, home front was very comfortable, and that is another hurdle. Somebody called my wife, she said, Dr. Sancheti is moving so much, why don't you take drivers? What answer she gave? ड्राइवर्स लेने के लिए तो मिलना चाहिए ना, मिलते भी नहीं तो ड्राइवर्स कैसा लो, यू नो, ऐसा इतना तक मेरे को हर एक का कोऑपरेशन रहा, एंड दैट्स व्हाई हर्डल्स कुड गो आउट वेरी इजीली. थैंक यू. थैंक यू
सर. लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन, द सेशन विल गो अप टू 1 o'clock.
यू कैन,
या यू कैन आस्क अ क्वेश्चन.
सर, दिस क्वेश्चन आई एम आस्किंग टू यू,
यस,
एज अ प्रैक्टिशनर ऑफ वैल्यूज एंड आल्सो एज अ गुड पर्सन.
The thing is, the values are very important in the life. And years back, many, many years back, there used to be moral classes in the school level. But it is not there now. But as in the way society is going, we can see that society is becoming more and more materialistic on an average.
Yes, yes.
But for some exceptions. So, and any values to imbibe or any values to embed in the best period is to give in the childhood.
Right.
So, do you think is there a need for reintroduction of the moral classes in the education system? Because I don't know, silently it has been given by, I think maybe 30 years back or 20, I don't know. What is your advice?
Who is talking? I just, you. Repeat your last question. In short.
As an elder person and also as a practitioner, the values that I have seen now.
Yes.
All along your life, you have respected your parents,
correct.
Teachers, everything. These values go a long way. So
correct.
What is your advice to?
Yes. Two points. Number one, changing pattern in the practice towards commercial aspect, and your requirement in life, what you should have. Now, like each and every business, medical thing has become, from profession, has gone to a commercial aspect, to a business. So, any new doctor, when he comes and he wants to have more practice, he will offer some percentage to the general practitioners, like land seller takes a commission from person who wants to sell the land, and the person who wants to buy the land, commission. So that commission aspect, unfortunately, has come to medical practice with the basis of demand and supply. That has brought down the ethical value of the medical profession in the term, some places, unnecessary operations are being done, unnecessary investigations have been done, and sometimes more than surgeon, a general practitioner tells, isko operation karke fracture ko bithao, nail karo, wo karo. So, now, how to bring down this situation? Bring down this situation is only one thing I have to do, one has to do, to bring up the uplift our culture to such an extent that one will not be tempted to go for that practice. It's a long process, long process. But if you, when I teach my students, I tell them, I give them a story. When I wanted in 65, wanted a telephone to my hospital, I gave 10,000 rupees to that officer who can give me the telephone. But I told him, if I'm a telephone officer, I will not take money. But I had to give money because telephone was necessary. So the first step to stop this unethical practice is I tell my consultant, if you have to give money to general practitioners, give. But don't take money from the X-ray man, from the MRI, from the CT scan. That Marathi mein baat karte hai, ke by taking away the food attached to the teeth, if you eat it, your stomach could not be fulfilled. Don't go by that kind of cheap money which eats your conscience. So that kind of teaching I give every day to my consultant, and I'm happy to tell you they are able to do so. Another thing, very important, I tell to my students, and you are all also belonging to that category, we are professionals. Everybody has to grow, but we don't need money to grow. We need knowledge to grow. So acquire knowledge, grow in your knowledge. Certain amenities like good house, good car, good status in the society, you can get by your contribution, you can get by your behavior. So, businessman needs money to grow. Then some teacher asked me, I teach only in school, where I can grow? I told him, you can grow by teaching same thing to the students, go one step ahead to tell the values of the life to them, and that's how you can grow. If your children tomorrow can, if your students tomorrow become a Prime Minister of India or somebody else, is that not a good contribution of yours? If your co-workers grow and they do some invention, if you do some invention, that is a growth we can enjoy in life. And therefore, I always say, we have restricted needs, good house, good money to take in the care of our retired life in case you retire. In case you retire, very important, don't retire. And money to give education to the children, good house, good car, not a very sophisticated car, that is all right. If you get that, you should be immensely satisfied. Don't compare yourself with anybody, and never, never, never so with a businessman, and never so with a builder. Yes.
Replacement surgery. Now polio is also not common.
Yes.
It was very common. Now knee surgery is becoming very popular.
Yes.
Is there any way of prevention?
Very important. Very important. Knee gets worn out very easily than any other part of the joint because getting up from sitting position is taking body weight against gravity. Climbing the staircase is against gravity. 40% of the ladies in India are osteoporotic. 38% male in India are osteoporotic. Osteoporotic bone, without muscle exercise, the bone wears out very faster. So, a regular exercise to develop the quadriceps muscles is first aspect. I believe in the home remedy. After the age of 45, 55, whenever knee starts talking, you know, starts telling you, "Arre thoda kuch abhi kuch ho raha hai," take castor oil and any other Ayurvedic oil like Narayan Tel or any other Ayurvedic oil which says use for lubrication outside. Mix them 50-50, sit and yourself sitting in the chair, take half a spoon on each hand and apply it all in front, behind, before you go to bed. And again, before you take bath, apply that time and do self-massage. Move it in front and behind. That increases the circulation, increases the blood supply, and prevents the deterioration of the knee joint. Cartilage doesn't come, but doesn't wear fast. It's more preventive, more preventive. Number two, exercises have got no substitute. Sitting in the chair, raising the leg up, bending it down, making it straight, lying on the tummy, bending the knee, making it straight, standing, holding the chair, standing on the toes, standing on the heel. This kind of simple exercises for 10, 15 minutes can take good care of your knee. So add these few exercises to your other exercise program, which will prevent you getting arthritis of the knee. No. This is all gimmicks. Knee surgery, electromagnetic waves, or some other gimmicks given by paper publicity is zero value. Yourself doing regular exercises and little massage with castor oil is immensely beneficial. Out of my 50 years practice, I can tell you, very many patients have come to me for replaced. I thought they can walk for a mile and a half. While climbing the staircase, they don't get tired. Then why should I do the knee replacement? I gave them this particular combination along with food cartilage supplement medicine, glucosamine food supplement, and they have not come back again for knee replacement. Neither they have gone for anybody to get knee replaced. It is possible to avoid the knee replacement surgery in the initial period if you take care this way. Thank you. Yes.
Being a huge amount of knowledge, which possibly you share with your students, what about globalizing this kind of knowledge? Not only yours, sir, there would be in terms of videos or in terms of some expert knowledge database, so that it doesn't get lost.
There's
huge experience and repository of knowledge. Is there any way this can be done?
What
and do you have any
thoughts? Asking your knowledge can be.
Yeah. Right, right. My son is also telling me like that. I should accumulate them, publish a book together, make a book or present it somewhere. My Sonal daughter and son, they are trying to do this and I will do it, madam. Thank you very much for that kind of suggestion.
Doctor, you've taken care of this very vital prevention of your
infection. Who is talking?
I'm talking.
Yes, yes, yes.
Prevention of infection is more critical.
Yes.
Surgery and post-surgery.
Yes.
And those days, I fully appreciate the effort you have taken in introducing laminar flow.
Yes.
And HEPA filters for preventing 0.5 microns.
Yes.
0.3 microns.
0.3.
Okay. What was the post-operative care? How could you prevent this infection? Because that's more critical and it involves a lot of interaction. Rather than having your own setup.
Correct.
Operation theater, you had a setup, you could prevent infection.
Yes.
Post-operative, it takes a lot of time for them to recover. During that stage, it's
more
critical.
Correct.
I think...
Correct. As I told you, 90% of the post-operative infection is intra-operative. The germs go inside while you are operating. If I move my hand this way, more than thousands of dust particles and bacteria on there get displaced from one person to another person. And therefore, when you open the door with a gush of air, lot of dust particles come and your theater gets infected. So one way is during surgery, keep the door closed and doesn't allow air movement to occur, number one. Number two, seal the post-operative wound with material like tegaderm, that even though if you split on that wound or take bath, no, there will not be contamination from outside to the wound. Don't open the wound till for 3 days till there is a blood oozing and making the inner dressing reddish. Antibiotic cover, start half an hour before surgery and continue for 3 days to avoid the proliferation of bacteria during that period. And this plus early movement. Olden days, the patient was kept in bed with the idea the wound should heal well, don't move. No. Start the movement early, which will prevent the blood clotting in the veins of the leg and reduce the mortality, reduce the ill feeling after operation, and that will improve your resistance. So early mobilization, dressing of the wound with airtight bandage, 3 days antibiotics is the crux to prevent the infection. However, the room where you are kept should not be so many people sitting there, at least in the first 3 days. No more people coming from outside in the initial 3 days, which unnecessarily will have another airborne contamination in your body and reduce your resistance. These small tips can avoid post-operative infection to a great extent. Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Tarun. I am from Indore.
Yes.
It's wonderful job that you have been carrying, changing life of so many people.
Thank you, sir.
I want to ask you one technical question, like yes. These implants that you have been designing and making.
Yes.
How do you make sure that they are compatible to the body?
Right. The material used is one cobalt chrome alloy. There is a cobalt 90%, 6% aluminum, and 4% vanadium. This combination has been used for years together that they are allergic to body. Only the nickel is one which found they are sometimes allergic to the body and they can give different kind of tissues. Second aspect is a polyethylene. Ultra high molecular weight, high density polyethylene has found to be suitable to the body and there are no adverse reactions or foreign body reactions to this material. So as far as the material is concerned, the material being used at present are time tested and proven that inert to the body tissue, body plasma, etc., etc. The newer material of bearing surfaces like ceramic or ceramic on one part or a coated stainless steel with ceramic or carbon coated or some other things are being used to reduce the wear rate and increase the durability of the implant. They have found over a period of time not very unhappy. There's no unhappy findings about the body tissue reaction. So, therefore, it's not a major issue. The biggest enemy of any surgery is infection. And if infection doesn't occur, second enemy is a wear. And third enemy, if you don't fit it well to the body, aseptic loosening of the implant. So, if you take a proper care of fixing the implant with good cement interface, balancing the tissue very well, and implant tested implant, then there is no problem. Yes?
Precision machines.
Yes.
But nowadays, like I work on laser, so you can fabricate by laser molding,
yes,
things. So you can make a drawing, 3D,
yes,
drawing, and auto
3D printing.
And then you can print.
Correct. Nowadays, equipment is available like 3D printing, or I use the titanium powder and make an implant, take the CT scan, and using CT scan, feed it to the machine and develop that shape accordingly. But they are very expensive. Very common. Instead of that, what people do nowadays, develop the specific implants develop the specific instruments by this process to for a particular patient. They will give precise cuts, and then this implant with cobalt chrome alloy and ultra-high density polyethylene could be used, and the fitting, well-fitting, can give longevity. So this 3D printing and other innovations are used only in the cases where there is a tumor cancer diagnosis, where bone has been destroyed irregularly, and more than only the joint, other part of the bone is also to be replaced. For that kind of situation, this technology is very useful. Not for the routine changing of the hip and knee joint. Thank you. Yeah, please.
Your extraordinary, inspiring talk.
Please. I would like ask to any question, including personal life.
I would like to bring out some statistics in India.
Yes.
Especially in India, though, because of change in lifestyle and other degradation in the food habits and other things, more and more people are falling sick.
Yes.
With respect to many problems.
Yes.
But the availability of good medical facilities are still mere as it is.
Yes.
For many, majority of the people. There is a need that doctor to population ratio, I mean to be increased further. But it is not happening in India. So what is your advice to the government that the way engineers were produced more, but not doctors in India. So how to tackle this situation so that India will become a very healthy country in the coming years?
Right. The patient to doctor population in India is so poor. We are the third lowest in the world, other than African countries. That is one aspect, the demand and supply point. Another point, we doctors are not ready to go to taluka places and rural areas where 70 to 80% of the population is staying. Everybody wants to concentrate in major cities and metro cities, and that's why the facilities are not available to that extent. Third, the modern science is growing on one side, and basic requirement of sanitation, etc., is not being taken care to the rural areas. So my advice would be, the primary health centers in the taluk places and the villages should be empowered with good equipment. The doctors staying there should given a good pay so that they can stay, give some incentive to do some private practice, and increase, motivate them. First is the motivation from inside. Passion. To create a passion is equally important than giving the facilities to work in the rural areas. If this somehow government is able to do, then perhaps there would be good change in future to see, in my opinion.
Yeah. That will be the last question. Yeah.
My,
sure. Who is asking? Yes.
My request to you.
Yes.
Is that can you tell something on the use of alternative healing system?
Correct. Correct.
For in general.
Yes.
Maybe particularly for orthopedic.
Right. I am a person who believes in homeopathy, Ayurveda, and all other things. I had some problem in my bottle. There are homeopathic tablets. I don't mind to show you that I'm taking some homeopathic treatment also. So we must keep our mind open. Except antibiotics and acute conditions, there is a very good alternative therapy available as a holistic approach. And therefore, we must come all these pathways together, sit together, and evolve a strategy where one is all the three people are taught all the three pathways. And they can then select the patient, whatever they come, and use them. I am of the opinion who believe in holistic approach and want to use all the pathways. In my practice of arthritic treatment non-operatively, 60% are Ayurvedic drugs, 60%. And 25% painkillers and 10% food supplement for cartilage regeneration. But allopathy drugs, painkillers, I say jokingly, they relieve the pain for 5 hours, but make the ulcer permanent in the body. Don't use them. Go to the allopathy, go to the Ayurveda. They have got tremendous, so many nice drugs. What has happened? Certain companies, they come out with some formula and then they ask people to take it without going into sort of real use of that. And they are not allowing science to grow. Government is trying to develop the Ayurveda and homeopathy, no doubt. But I don't know how and when it happened that the research in Ayurveda and homeopathy is done to that extent that is done. I went and asked the homeopath how this medicine works. He said, I don't know. I find it works and I give you. So I said, if anybody knows how homeopathy works, he will be the richest person in the world. But such research should go on, both in homeopathy and Ayurveda, so that all the three pathies can go together and give combined support to the patients. Yes.
I'm Raja. Actually, as you were telling us, sir, that homeopathy and Ayurveda, both these things are also very good apart from allopathy.
Yes.
In your experience, have you used homeopathy before and after surgery, sir? As I know, I've done a first aid course in homeopathy.
Yes.
There are few medicines which are given before operation.
Yes.
And to avoid any aftershocks.
Yes.
There are certain medicines.
The person who gives me homeopathic treatment, he is a MD in pharmacology. After 3 years after MBBS, he completed that course. He definitely believes that certain homeopathic drugs after surgery can reduce the inflammatory edema and reduce the pain.
One drug is Stratisacria, which people use it.
Yes.
For any clean surgical cuts,
correct.
That's the best medicine.
Yes.
Which
and for trauma, Arnica. For
Arnica,
trauma.
Yes.
That is a very good drug. If you take along with some other drugs, as soon as the wound is there, you take some Arnica, and that helps for early healing. So such drugs, we allopathic people should use with open mind. I very strongly recommend that.
Actually, if we look at in England,
yes,
most of the hospitals would be having, in the allopathy hospitals would be having a wing of homeopathy.
Yes.
Where they start with that and end with that.
Correct.
In between, we have the
I agree.
Allopathic treatment.
I agree.
Sir, are you put... Yeah. In your cases?
I use it to, nowadays I'm doing some experiments. I'm asking my one or two people to use it. 50% cases use it, 50% don't use it and see the defect. I'm in that phase now.
You are the best person to take that exercise.
Yes.
Because that will be helping a lot.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we are running out of time. The pearls of wisdom which Dr. Sancheti, the 24/7 doctor who has given it us is worth emulating by all of us in our life. But we can continue on, but for the time. So now I would formally request Commandant H.S. More to propose the vote of thanks on behalf of the course and NIAS.
Professor Valde Raj, Dr. Chindamram, program coordinators, and distinguished past citizens. I feel honored and privileged to get an opportunity to propose a vote of thanks for the first session of the 30th NIH program for the senior executives on to lead a change. Dr. K. Sancheti, founder, president, chief orthopedic surgeon, one of the Asia's top three orthopedic hospitals in Pune, and the first orthopedic doctor of Pune. Visionary is the apt word to describe Dr. Sancheti, who right from the inception to late 1972, he has been endlessly working for the benefit of the mankind. We are greatly encouraged and feel immensely benefited by a person who has been revolutionary in the field of orthopedics. Sir, we are also impressed with your honest confession, I'm sure nobody will tell, of your life, learning lessons, the stages of your life through which you underwent, in your career, including the multitasking environment, your role in invention, healthcare, passion, bringing in change, community work, achievements in the field of work, including patients, specialized services, your philosophical approach will surely inspire us to lead a change. On behalf of all the participants, I convey deep regards and healthy thanks to Dr. Sancheti for gracing the first session and sharing a vision with us. Thank you, sir.
Gentlemen, let's give a standing ovation to the doctor.